ఇంటర్మీడియట్ విద్యా రంగంలో అగ్రగామి మన ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ ఇన్స్టిట్యూషన్ ఐఐటి జేఈఈ అయినా నీట్ అయినా తిరుగులేని విద్యా సంస్థ ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్.
వాట్ ఆర్ ది సీక్వెన్షియల్ లేయర్స్ ఇన్ హార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ది పర్సన్ ఇన్క్లూడింగ్ పెరికార్డియల్ లేయర్స్ ఫ్రమ్ ఔటర్ టు ఇన్నర్ ఇన్క్లూడింగ్ పెరికార్డియల్ లేయర్స్. What are the layers in a sequence in the heart of the person means outermost layer is the fibrous pericardium, below to that parietal serous pericardium, below to that this is the pericardial fluid, below to that visceral serous pericardium, below to that epicardium, below to that myocardium, below to that endocardium is present. So that only what are the sequential layers which may be present in heart of the person including pericardium from outer to inner. Sequential layers in heart including pericardium. Sequential layers in heart including pericardium from outer to inner or outermost layer is the fibrous pericardium. Outermost layer is below to that parietal serous pericardium is present. Below to that pericardial fluid, below to that visceral serous pericardium, visceral serous pericardium is present. Below to that epicardium, below to that myocardium, below to that endocardium are present. Sequential layers in the heart in including pericardium from outer to inner. Including pericardial layers, what are the sequential layers from outer to inner means fibrous pericardium, parietal serous pericardium, pericardial fluid, visceral serous pericardium, epicardium, myocardium, endocardiums are present as the sequence. Sequential layers in heart from outer to inner including pericardial layers. Next to external structure of heart, next to external structure of heart of person, external structure of heart. Definitely, what is the external structure of the heart of the person means heart is triangular in shape. Heart of the person is triangular in shape means four chambered heart is present. this four chambered heart is look like as triangular in shape. In this, upper chambers are said to be as the atria, lower chambers are said to be as the ventricle. These two are the atria, these two are the ventricle. Definitely anterior surface, this is the anterior surface, is broad, posterior surface is pointed. Definitely in heart of the person, though it is externally look like as a triangular in shape, this anterior part of the heart is broad, posterior surface is with the apex or pointed. Again, this atria as well as ventricles are gets separated from each other by a folding externally. Just assume these are the just assume these are nothing but atrias. Just assume these are the atrias, these are ventricle. So this atrias are separated from ventricle externally by a folding, by a groove. This kind of the groove is said to be as the coronary sulcus. That groove is said to be as the coronary sulcus. Means externally both atrias are separated from ventricle by a folding. This is the folding, this is the groove. That groove is said to be as the coronary sulcus. Just assume like this. This is the heart chamber. In this case, these are atrias, these are ventricle. Externally, this atrias are separated from ventricle by a groove. That groove is said to be as the coronary sulcus. In this case, these are the posterior walls of atria. Just assume these are the atrias, these are ventricle. These are the posterior walls of atria. The posterior walls of atria, which projected over anterior wall of ventricle, posterior wall of atria, which projected over the anterior wall of ventricle, such projections are said to be as the auricular appendix. Here you should remember two important words. What is coronary sulcus? What is auricular appendix? Coronary sulcus nothing but both sides of the, just assume these are atrias, this is ventricle. Both sides of the atrias are separated from ventricle by a transverse groove. That transverse groove is said to be as the coronary sulcus. In this case, this posterior margins of atria projected over anterior walls of ventricle. That posterior walls of atrias, which projected over the anterior wall of ventricle, is said to be as the auricular appendix. Similarly, both sides of the ventricle, just assume this is the right ventricle, this is the left ventricle. Both sides of the ventricles also separated from each other by a groove. This is the left ventricle, this is the right ventricle, these are atrias. So definitely this left ventricle and right ventricle is also separated from each other by a groove. That groove is said to be as the interventricular groove. This groove is said to be as the interventricular groove. So definitely externally but not internally both sides of the ventricles are separated by each other by the septum, interventricular septum, but externally both sides of the ventricles are separated from each other by a groove that is said to be as the interventricular groove. Definitely externally atrias are separated from ventricle by the coronary sulcus. Both sides of the ventricles are separated from each other by interventricular groove externally. Next, when we observe the internal structure of heart of the person, when we observe the internal structure, internal structure of heart of person, internally four chambers are very clearly appear. Of this, upper chambers are said to be as the atria, lower chambers are said to be as the ventricle. Of this is said to be as the right atria, this is the left atria, this is the right ventricle, this is the left ventricle. So in the case of the internal structure of heart of the person, four chambers are very clearly appear. Of this is the right atria, this is left atria, this is the right ventricle, this is the left ventricle. In this case, this is right atria, this is the left atria, this is right ventricle, this is left ventricle. So definitely when we observe the thickness of walls of atria, is less than thickness of walls of ventricle. Atrial walls are less thick when compared to the ventricular walls, because atria simply receive blood from the various parts of the body and temporarily store that, later they deliver that into the respective side of the ventricle. Ventricles have to be pumped that blood to the various parts of the body with the high pressure. For example, right ventricle have to pump the blood to the lungs. Definitely right ventricle have to pump the blood to the lung. Left ventricle have to pump the blood to body parts. Definitely this kind of the ventricles have to pump the blood to the various parts of the body, so that only they have to be contract forcefully to pump the blood with the pressure to the various parts of the body. So that only their walls are more thick when compared to the atria. Very important point in the objective. Atrial walls are less thick when compared to the ventricular walls, because ventricles have to forcefully contract to exert a higher pressure on the blood to pump it to various parts of the body. For successfully pumping of blood to various parts of the body, ventricles must be contracted with high force. Then only it is possible to pump the blood with high pressure to the various parts of the body. So that only ventricular walls are more thick when compared to the atria. Again, left ventricle wall is more thick when compared to the right ventricle wall. Definitely right ventricle wall thickness is greater than atria. Right ventricle wall thickness is greater than both sides of the atria. But when compared to the left ventricle, right ventricle wall is less thick. When compared to the left ventricle wall, right ventricle wall is less thick. What is the reason? What is the reason for left ventricular wall is with more thick when compared to the right ventricular wall? Means right ventricles only pump the blood to the lungs. Lungs are located on either side of the heart. Lungs are located very close to the heart. So that only, though right ventricle contract with less force, it's enough to pump that kind of the blood to the lung. But left ventricle have to pump the blood to the far distant part of the body. Far distant part means definitely blood have to be pumped to the palm of the person. Blood have to be pumped to the tip of the finger. Blood have to be pumped to the tip of the toe of leg. Definitely tip of the finger is far distant to heart. Tip of the toe of leg is far distant to heart. To successfully pump the blood to the far distant part of the body, this left ventricle must be contracted with high force. Then only it is possible to get to pump the blood to the far distant part of the body. So that only left ventricle walls are more thick when compared to the right ventricle. Once again I want to repeat this. Why the left ventricle walls are more thick when compared to the right ventricular wall? Means left ventricle how to pump the blood to the far distant part of the body. So that only it have to be contracted with the high pressure. It have to be contracted with high force. Then only it is possible to pump the blood to the far distant part of the body. But right ventricle always pump the blood to the lungs only. Lungs are located near to the heart. They are very close to the heart. So that only right ventricle, though it is contracted with low force, it is enough to pump the blood to the lung. Due to that reason, left ventricle wall is more thick when compared to the right ventricle. What is the sequence? What is the ascending or descending order of thickness of the walls of the heart chamber? Ascending order of thickness of heart chambers. What is the ascending order of the thickness of the heart chambers? Means left atrial wall is less thick when compared to the
right atria.
Right atrial wall is less thick
when compared to the right ventricle.
Right ventricle wall is less thick
when compared to the left ventricle.
So what is the ascending order of thickness of heart chambers means? Left atrial wall thickness is less than right atrial wall. Right atrial wall is less thick when compared to the right ventricle wall. Right ventricle wall is less in thick when compared to the left ventricle wall. Size is also same. Size is also same. Ascending order of thickness of heart chambers as well as size of the heart chamber sequence also same. Definitely left atria size is less than right atria. Means when we observe these two, size of the right atria is greater than left atria. Similarly, size of the right ventricle is less than size of left ventricle. Left ventricle size is greater than right ventricle. So that only size as well as thickness of heart chamber sequence is ascending order of the thickness of heart chambers. Size, ascending order of the size of the heart chambers is also same. They are same. Definitely left atria size as well as thickness is less than right atria. Right atria size as well as thickness is less than right ventricle. Right ventricle size as well as thickness is less than left ventricle. The size, ascending order of the size of heart chambers, ascending order of the thickness of heart wall is also same. Definitely size also same. Left atria size is small than right atria. Right atria size is small than right ventricle. Right ventricle size is small than left ventricle. So that only size as well as the thickness is same. Ascending order of thickness and size of the heart chambers is left atria is less than right atria. Right atria is less than right ventricle. Right ventricle is less than left ventricle. This is very important in NEET examination point of view. Thickness of ascending order of thickness of heart wall and ascending order of the size of the heart chambers is same. That is the, this is the sequence. Again, when we observe the upper chambers are atria. After this is the right atria, that is the left atria. Right atria always receive deoxygenated blood from the various parts of the body. Left atria always receive oxygenated blood from the lungs. Left atria always receives oxygenated blood from the lung. Right atria always receives deoxygenated blood from the various parts of the body. Right atria, left atrias internally separated from each other by a muscular, very thin muscular wall, that is said to be as the interatrial septum. Definitely right atria separated from left atria by a thin muscular wall, that is said to be as the interatrial septum. Definitely this is the thin muscular wall. Interatrial septum is a thin muscular wall. Interatrial septum separate both sides of the atrias internally, externally but not externally. But not externally, internally. Internally, right atria, left atrias are separated from each other by the interatrial septum, that is made up of a thin muscular wall. during the embryonic development, during the embryonic development means on or before the delivery, a small opening is present on interatrial septum that is said to be as the foramen ovale. That is said to be as the foramen ovale. On interatrial septum, opening which is present during the embryonic development, opening which is present, that opening is said to be as the foramen ovale. But after immediate delivery, after immediate delivery or soon off delivery, this foramen ovale is gets close and leaving a patch. That kind of the patch is said to be as the fossa ovalis. Fossa ovalis. During the embryonic development, opening which is present on interatrial septum is said to be as the foramen ovale. But after delivery, definitely that will be closes by leaving a patch. That kind of the patch is said to be as the fossa ovalis. Fossa ovalis is nothing but a remnant of foramen ovale. Remnant means it's a symbol. Remnant nothing but it's a remnant part or it's a symbol. That is nothing but fossa ovalis is nothing but remnant of foramen ovale. Means after closing that foramen ovale, whatever the patch which is appears, that is said to be as the fossa ovalis. Definitely, what is the use of that foramen ovale during the embryonic development? Means during embryonic development, lungs are becomes non-functional. Lungs are not gets functional during the embryonic development. After the delivery of the child, lungs becomes functional. So that only during the embryonic development, lungs are non-functional. So during that, from the right atria, blood is directly pumped into the left atria without circulating to the lung. Without circulating to the lung during the embryonic development, from the right atria, blood is directly conducted into the, pumped into the left atria. So, but after the delivery, lungs becomes functional. So that only from the right atria, blood is not pumped into the left atria. Blood is pumped into the right ventricle from right atria, from where that is supplied to the lung after the delivery. So that only after the delivery, right atria never pump the blood to the left ventricle directly, left atria directly. Right atria pump the blood to the right ventricle, from where that will be supplied to the lung for purification after delivery. So that only after delivery, after lungs becomes functional, this foramen ovale is becomes close and leave a patch. That is said to be as the fossa ovalis. One more important, once I want to repeat that, this is very important in the objective. During the embryonic development only, on interatrial septum foramen ovale is present, because during the embryonic development lungs are non-functional. So that only right atria directly pump the blood to the left atria. But after the delivery, lungs becomes functional. So that only right atria directly pump the blood to the right ventricle, from where that will be pumped to the lung for purification. So that only after delivery, there is no need of presence of this foramen ovale. So that only foramen ovale is gets closes. So that only a patch is a final appear, that is said to be as the fossa ovalis. Again, right atria receives deoxygenated blood through major blood vessels of that. This is said to be as the post caval vein or inferior vena cava or vena cava. This is said to be as the post caval vein or inferior vena cava. From the posterior parts of the body, deoxygenated blood is collected by a big blood vessel. That is said to be as the post caval vein or the inferior vena cava. That is finally opens into right atria. This opening is guarded with a wall. That is said to be as the Eustachian wall. This is said to be as the Eustachian wall. The opening of post caval vein into the right atria is guarded with a valve that is said to be as the Eustachian wall. This is vestigial. This is vestigial in adult. This is only functional in embryonic development. Eustachian valve is in working only during the embryonic development, but whenever the person, whenever the child is gets delivered, whenever this foramen ovale is becomes close, then onwards it becomes non-functional. Means Eustachian valve is in functional during the embryonic development, but in the adult person that is the vestigial, that is non-functional. Similarly, right atria receives deoxygenated blood from anterior part of the body through another big blood vessels. They are said to be as the free caval veins. These are the free caval veins. Definitely this is the left side, right side of the free caval vein. This is the left side of the free caval vein. Both the free caval veins are finally opens into right atria through common opening. These are the free caval veins or superior vena cava. These are said to be as the superior vena cava or free caval vein. From anterior parts of body, from anterior part of the body means specifically from the head region, from the shoulders, from the forearms, definitely deoxygenated blood is collected by free caval veins. Free caval veins are of two. This is the right side of the free caval vein, this is the left side of the free caval vein. These two are the free caval veins. They opens into the right atria through common opening, but this opening is without any wall. Free caval veins opening is without any wall. Similarly, means this is the left free caval vein. This is the right free caval vein. Right free caval vein. This is the right free caval vein. This is the left free caval vein. These two caval veins always receive deoxygenated blood from the anterior part of the body. Similarly, this right atria also receive deoxygenated blood from the heart wall. Right atria also receives deoxygenated blood from the heart walls through a blood vessel.
This is said to be as the coronary sinus.
Definitely, right atria receives deoxygenated blood from the heart walls, through a blood vessel. That is said to be as the coronary sinus.
This opening of the coronary sinus,
into right atria
is guarded with a wall. That valve is said to be as the Tebbiceous wall. That is said to be as the Tebbiceous wall.
The opening of coronary sinus into right atria. Is guarded with a valve that is said to be as the Tebbiceous valve. You should remember, post-caval vein opening into the right atria is guarded with the Eustachian valve. That is the vestigial in adult, that is functional in embryonic development only.
Similarly, coronary sinus opening into the right atria is also guarded with a valve. That is said to be as the Tebbiceous valve.
This is the Tebbiceous valve. Coronary sinus always collect deoxygenated blood from the heart walls. From the both sides of the heart wall, deoxygenated blood is collected by the coronary sinus. Again, left atria always collect oxygenated blood from the lungs through four pulmonary veins. Collect oxygenated blood from the lung and finally deliver it to the left atria.
Definitely, into the left atria, from the both sides of the lungs, oxygenated blood gets delivered by the four pulmonary veins.
These are the two pulmonary veins of this lung.
Totally, four pulmonary veins deliver oxygenated blood into the left atria from the lungs. Just assume this is the left atria. These are the pulmonary veins. They are four in number.
So definitely, from the both sides of the lungs, oxygenated blood is collected by four pulmonary veins, finally deliver that into the left atria. Again, between the both sides of the atrias and ventricle, a thick fibrous connective tissue wall is present. Between the both sides of the atrias and ventricle. That is said to be as the interatrioventricular septum.
So definitely, between the both sides of the atria and ventricle, whatever the fibrous connective tissue wall is present, which is very thick, that is said to be as the interatrioventricular septum. It's not made up of the muscle.
It is made up of with thick fibrous connective tissue. So that thick fibrous connective tissue wall which is present between the both sides of the atria and both sides of the ventricle, that is said to be as the interatrioventricular septum. This is made up of with thick fibrous connective tissue or fibrous tissue. Again, on this interatrioventricular septum, between the right atria and the right ventricle, one opening is present. Similarly, between the left atria and the left ventricle also another opening is present. This is the opening between the right atria and the right ventricle. This is the opening between the right atria and the right ventricle. So in that way, on interatrioventricular septum, openings are present between the right atria and the right ventricle, left atria and the left ventricle. This opening which is present between the right side of atria and ventricle is said to be as the right atrioventricular aperture. Opening which is present between the right atria and the right ventricle is said to be as the right atrioventricular aperture, that is the opening. Similarly, opening which is present between the left atria and the left ventricle, that opening is said to be as the left atrio ventricular aperture. That is said to be as the left atrioventricular aperture. That is the opening. This right atrioventricular aperture is guarded with a valve. That valve is said to be as the tricuspid valve. This right atrioventricular aperture is guarded with a valve. Right atrioventricular aperture is guarded with a valve that is said to be as the tricuspid valve. This is the tricuspid valve. This tricuspid valve always allows flow of the blood from the right atria into right ventricle only. That never allows the reverse flow of the blood from the right ventricle into the right atria. Always that allows flow of the blood from the right atria into right ventricle only. That never allows the reverse flow of the blood. What is the position of the, just assume this is the right atrioventricular aperture. This tricuspid valve is present like this. From the atria, if the blood is tries to flow into the ventricle, they open. While the blood from the atria is pumped into the ventricle, they will open. Whenever the ventricles are gets contracted, then immediately they may be closes. Means this valve, tricuspid valve, always allows the flow of the blood from atria into ventricle. While the blood is tries to reversely flow from ventricle into atria, they may be closes like this. So that only atrioventricular apertures, right atrioventricular aperture is guarded with a valve, that is the tricuspid valve. Similarly, left atrioventricular aperture is guarded with a valve, that is said to be as the bicuspid valve. This is the bicuspid valve or mitral valve. Definitely, left atrioventricular aperture is guarded with a valve. that is said to be as the bicuspid valve or the mitral valve. This is also allows the flow of blood from the left atrium to left ventricle only, that never allows the reverse flow of the blood. So in that way, bicuspid valve as well as tricuspid valve, both of them are made up of with Dennehy irregular connective tissue. Both valves are made up of with Dennehy irregular connective tissue. Both of them always useful to allow the flow of the blood from the atria into ventricles only. This bicuspid as well as tricuspid valves collectively called as AV valve.
Tricuspid valves together called as atrioventricular valves are simply AV valves.
So why the bicuspid tricuspid valves are called as the atrioventricular valves means they are present between the atrias and ventricle. These valves are present between the atrias and ventricle, so that only they are said to be as the atrioventricular valves or AV valve.